This is my C64 bread bin, and this is the GGLabs GLINK-LT, which adds an RS232 port to your C64, allowing it to act as a serial terminal. The question is, can the C64 compete against this 1978 DEC VT100 terminal? Retro computing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. This episode is sponsored by PCBWay.com, your source for CNC machining, 3D printing, PCBs and more. Actually, I wanted to pursue this topic since last year already. The idea came when I was assembling the PDP-11 replica, thinking that I should actually have a physical terminal instead of a modern day's machine using terminal emulation. But then two things happened. For one, this original DEC VT100 terminal found its way to me. And while I did get this GLINK-LT serial adapter from GGLabs, having the DEC terminal lowered the priority for going into the topic. And furthermore, my daughter hammered around on the C64's keyboard, leaving it in dysfunctional state. And so far, time didn't permit me into venturing into the C64 repair. Now, to be frank, I've no idea on repairing these things, as I never had to do so until now. After reading around about what could potentially be wrong with this machine, I decided to start using an in-depth system inspection. I saw that there's some people who seem to be able to do some measurements to tell what's wrong with the C64, but that's certainly beyond my level of knowledge here. So I went with a diagnostic harness to begin with. You can get these in many places, and while there seems to be some variation here and there, they all seem to go back to one common design originally done by Commodore themselves. Now, I got mine from a seller called Axel81L on eBay. And when it arrived, I realized it was just naked with no additional documentation, hence I did another research. Eventually I came across by this forum here, where it's claimed that the seller being a cloner, stealing other people's design. Well, I don't know. I went a bit further, eventually ending up on this informative website, pointing me even further to Sven Peterson's site, where he provided some GPL designs. Now, should I have accidentally fallen into the trap of a copycat, then I'm really sorry. I'm just pointing it out here, and I decided to leave the rest to your discretion. I'm not here to judge. For the very least, I hope the harness is functional, so I'm about to plug it in. The individual components have a silkscreen, and in most cases a label denoting top and bottom side. So I assume if I plug it in this way that the top label faces upwards, then it should be in the correct orientation. Now, to also test the keyboard controller, and this is my main motivation here, I have to open the case and unplug the keyboard. And while the inline header is keyed with that missing pin, the diagnostics card doesn't actually have a blind socket, so it's easy to actually plug it in reverse. You have to pay attention to this small rectangular shape, which denotes the key for the correct orientation. Once powering up, the ROM on the diagnostics cartridge will load right away and begin with the test sequence. And it totally looks functional and absolutely the same way as what was described in the German C64 wiki, so I have no reason to believe it's a fake. Actually, I did a simple test by omitting the keyboard test unit, and you see here that the test software is claiming it to be in open state when unconnected, and actually returning OK once installed. The test repeats in an endless loop over and over again, and it seems to assert that my C64 here is actually OK. So what's up with the keyboard? I went to start the C64 from the SD to IEC and was totally surprised to find it was actually working, or working again. So maybe just disconnecting and reseating everything was all it took after all. At least I have something small to fix here. There's some broken off plastic here, which causes the screw to essentially fall through. I'm filling it up using a two components plastic glue, which will harden out within seconds. This way I can drill a new hole, which will properly retain the screw. Okay, so the C64 works, but what about the serial adapter? I got myself this one here by GGLabs, the GLINK-LT. It came as a bare PCB as well, so I had to organize myself an enclosure, as I don't think this one should stay connected to the C64 permanently like this. I found a matching enclosure prototype on Thingiverse, so once more someone had done the work already before me. That's awesome, as it essentially spares me the design time. So I went again with PCBWay, whom is sponsoring me for the reproduction parts, and had them produce this enclosure for me. PCBWay is offering dozens of prototype materials, but at the time I'm really in favor of resin, as it has a very clean surface finish from the get-go. I'm really curious, as these parts have been delivered to me in May this year already, but so far I didn't get around into looking into it. Ah, look at this. PCBWay added some stickers and this acrylic logo along with the ball pen. Merchandise. And here come the parts. As you see, I have multiple small parts, like the prominent C from the Commodore logo. There's also this knob for the reset button and these small elements which also belong to the Commodore logo. I don't know why I have to red one twice, but it shall turn out to be very useful, as we're going to see in a minute. Last but not least, here comes the bottom and the top of the enclosure itself. And what shall I say, it really looks awesome. I'm really into resin, it looks totally clean with almost no visible traces of it being 3D printed. Now you notice of course some of the parts being dyed in blue and red. Not only will it look awesome having the logo in the right color scheme, but I wanted to try out the dyeing options available by PCBWay. And here's the comparison of the prices offered by PCBWay, ones for the regular parts in standard white and ones for the same parts with the spray paint applied. Actually, you can choose any Pantone color you like, but for being a bit pragmatic here, I went with the standard color choices. The reason is also when trying to figure out the correct colors of the Commodore logo, I got like a variation as shown here.
Maybe the Wikipedia one would have been the correct one.
Yeah, really? Ah, who cares, I'm rather into assembling the thing right now. But first I'll glue in these parts that make up the Commodore logo. I'll also print the label quickly, as I tend to forget things after a while. So I'll stick that label to the backside for my own reference to know what actual board type this is, as I definitely won't remember in a few months or years. I also need additional nuts and screws for mounting it all together. I have to take these from my own stock, as they didn't come with the serial adapter. Then I faced another interesting annoyance. My screws would not hold. Alright, maybe I should take other screws then. But I worked around it by filling the bottom side screw holes with hot melt, so here's some substance inside for the screws to seize. And here it is, fully assembled. Doesn't it look nice? Well, it looked nice, at least until I started fiddling around with it. The glue was not dried yet and eventually I messed up and had the glue spill out, and some of the dye dissolved, eventually marking some areas red. And it became a total mess. Bah!
Would it be appropriate to say you should have left it alone for a while?
Yes, yes, yes. But you know what? The mess became even bigger, as with the SD to IC adapter installed, it all turned out to be too wide, so I couldn't plug the serial adapter at the same time. It's only a few millimeters, but they really ruin it. So, now what to do? So I went to cut away some excess material, so it would plug in neatly. I had to take several runs, also with the Dremel. and since I cut off the outer wall, I had to refill it again with my two components' plastics glue. This then looks like this once dried. Not as nice as it originally was, but this is the risk when you're using any model without doing the measurements up front. At least, I can plug in the two modules now side by side, so there should be no further hold up for the functional testing. The GLINK-LT is a modern clone of the VIC-1011A RS232 adapter. And while it can run perfectly fine at 2400 baud in basic, it can act as a UP9600 to also allow 9600 baud operations. A 9600 baud is pretty much the bare minimum for any serial terminal if you want decent speed. But we wouldn't be able to use it had it been discovered by Daniel Dahlman how to bitbang 9600 baud over the user port, hence the name UP9600. Now, as of the 80s, there had been already the 6551 asynchronous communications interface adapter by MOS, and Commodore put them actually into some of their more business-oriented machines. The 6551 could actually do up to 19,200 baud, though for cost savings, something that Commodore's Jack Tramiel was very renowned for, a software-only implementation of the 6551 was implemented into the VIC-20, the C64 and the C128. Needless to say, the emulation was slow as hell and limited to 2400 baud only. And it didn't run stable at speeds over 1200 baud, at least until someone came up with a more reliable implementation many years later. But at the time, instead of using the built-in serial interface and to overcome its speed limitations, cartridges that go to the expansion ports were offered by some vendors. An example being the Turbo 232, which appeared in 1997 and can still be bought from GGLabs as a modern day's reproduction, providing speeds up to 115,200 baud. But for the serial terminal, 9600 is plenty, so I'm going with the user port variant. That's also because I didn't want to block the expansion port for using the Epic's fastload cartridge in parallel. Now, when it comes to the serial terminal software on the C64, there's plenty of options. We have StrikeTerm, which is a modified version originating from NovaTerm. Both of them support the UP9600 adapter, whereas GTerm64 does not. This one works only with cartridges like the GLINK 232. Then there's many more, like CTerm, CCGMS and others. Some of them offer plain terminal mode via serial connections but no UP9600 support, while others depend on having a real modem as they're intended for connecting to BBSs. It is perfectly possible to interface the C64 to bulletin board systems. You can also connect the C64 to a local peer machine, for example for performing file transfers from and to the C64, as most of these tools also implement set modem, xmodem, punter and other file transfer protocols. But the topic of today's episode is on using the C64 as a serial terminal, as in a remote display to another machine, and I spare the rest for a follow-up episode. So I was looking mostly into NovaTerm 9.6 and StrikeTerm. During my tests, I observed some random lockups here and there. Also, terminal mode seemed not to be working correctly. Luckily, the GLINK-LT comes with a reset button. So if your C64, like mine, has no modification for its own reset button, this comes in very handy as you can spare yourself to power cycle the C64 upon lockups. But still, I wondered what it's all about. Eventually, I reopened the case only to find that the jumpers were not correctly set. To have the GLINK-LT operate in UP9600 mode, all four jumpers have to be closed. I'm pretty certain that I put all four in place, but maybe I lost a jumper while fiddling around with the case assembly. Anyway, it seemed to make the trick and the lockups were gone. One imminent problem when using the C64 as a terminal is its limitation to the 40 columns mode. This page here explains it into detail how the stock implementation works, allocating an 8x8 bitmap for any character in 40x25 mode. And as the C64 doesn't support 80 columns mode natively, this has to be achieved by some trickery, essentially making the characters narrower to 4x8 pixels. But as you can imagine, readability suffers greatly from this approach. Both strike term and nova term support switching between 40 and 80 columns mode. Generally, lines would wrap around if they wouldn't fit the screen in 40 columns mode. But there is cases where this approach is unbearable, in particular when using full screen text mode applications which can't cope with 40 columns mode. Furthermore, some applications use so-called ANSI codes for applying color and on-screen placement of characters. Here you see the Ladder Game, a Donkey Kong clone for CPM, which is barely usable when running in a plain VT100 emulation. But once switching the emulation to ANSI, it looks a lot better, and it's well possible to actually play the game through the C64's terminal emulator. I must say though, that on camera, the C64 doesn't look as worse as when you're sitting right in front of it. Despite it being possible to use as a serial terminal, the character mode is definitely an issue, and in direct comparison, the DEC VT100 looks a lot better. Of course, that's no surprise, as that's exactly what the VT100 was built for, while, on the other hand, I somewhat shoehorned the terminal capability onto the C64. But still, it's an option, and actually the GLINK-LT can be used for so much more, like connecting to the internet. But that's for a future episode. In the end, I republished a modified version of the adapter's enclosure to Thingiverse. I didn't fix the width of the enclosure, as this is really dependent on your use case, and if you plug in something to the neighboring cassette port. But what I fixed is the orientation of the Commodore logo, as I really believe it should be flipped the other way round. And this concludes my look into the C64 being also a serial terminal. What do you think about it and its particular practicality? And would you agree that a C128 would probably make a better terminal using its natively supported 80 lines mode?
I think you should be using real terminals anyway. You kind of abused the C64 into doing something it doesn't natively do.
Well, that's also an opinion. I'm happy to go into further discussions on this topic via the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next week.